morning again. Pleasure to see you all here. My name is Mark Drayson. Secretary, welcome. Thank you. I'm the Executive Director of the Metropolitan Area Planning Council, which is the regional planning agency for Greater Boston. In addition to serving our 101 communities, basically all the communities inside I-495, we also have had the honor since 2001 of staffing and facilitating the Metropolitan Mayors Coalition, which is the coalition of the 14 mayors and managers from the most urbanized communities in the inner core, and bringing them together to work on issues of common concern and try to address those issues in a joint manner is really one of the pleasures of my job. It's enormously rewarding, and it demonstrates that even though this is an area that has a reputation for fierce home rule and for each one of our communities putting themselves first, we have pathways to collaboration and to communication, and the climate change work that the mayors and managers have agreed to do under the programs that we're going to be discussing today is yet further evidence of how successful and how impactful that work actually is. I feel compelled at this point, and we discussed this a little bit on the staff level, to just quickly mention what otherwise might be seen as an elephant in the room in regard to change that's taking place in Washington in January. One of the very fortunate things, we can't predict exactly what's going to happen on every topic, who's going to be in charge, what's going to be done, what words that have been stated in the past are actually going to come to pass. But we do know that here in Massachusetts, we understand that climate change is real. We understand that climate change is, for the most part, caused by human activity. And we are committed to addressing it both by doing our part to mitigate greenhouse gas emissions and also to adapt to those inevitable elements of climate change that are going to happen and that indeed are already happening in this region. From my perspective, in the position that I sit, and we do a lot of climate change work. I have wonderful staff members who are here today who do climate change work throughout the region and participate in statewide climate change work. From our perspective, one of the great things about our situation in Massachusetts is that virtually everybody understands that. We have a tremendously smooth and successful partnership among local officials, regional actors, the state legislature, and the administration of Governor Charlie Baker on understanding the impacts of climate change and moving forward with reasonable, determined efforts to address them. That's going to stay the same. That isn't going to change. We may have to redouble our efforts. We may have to be focused on what's going on in Washington and internationally in ways that maybe we weren't before, but we are going to continue those efforts. It's a commitment I know from MAPC. More importantly, probably, it's a commitment that you are going to see demonstrated over and over again as one person after another comes up here or speaks from their chairs on just rolling up our sleeves and dealing with this issue to the very, very best degree we possibly can. That's a commitment you have from me. I know you have that commitment from everyone else here today. So it is my tremendous pleasure to present not only a terribly active and participating member of the Metro Mayors Coalition, but also my mayor, and a leader in the climate change world, and that is Mayor Marty Walsh, to deliver some opening remarks. And Mayor Walsh, I don't know if you wish to do that from here, there, or if you wish to come up here, whatever is easier for you.
Thank you very much, Mark, and I want to thank you for everything you do in the Metro Mayors Coalition. I want to thank all of the support and the staff from the coalition for your great work as well. We get all the credit. We get to sit in front of the room and answer questions and ask questions, but it's really the work that happens behind the scenes from all of us here at the front, at the head table. Thank you to everyone for being here with us today. I want to thank all the mayors for being here as well. I want to extend a special thanks to Mayor Curtatone of Somerville for chairing the Metro Mayors. Thank you for your great work, Joe. Since the last time we convened, this coalition has made some incredible progress in top areas, which I'll get into. I also want to give a shout out to my former colleague from the House of Representatives, Matt Beaton. Is this all right? Keeps going in and out. Matt Beaton, the secretary, who has done an incredible job on the state. And we were just joking when Mark said the elephant in the room. I don't think the elephant's in the room. I think we know what it is. And we'll figure it out. Certainly in Boston and Massachusetts, we're not going to, we don't have to change. We're going to continue to move forward. And to have a partner like Matt Beaton is extremely important. So thank you, Matt, for your great work here in the Commonwealth. But since 2015, as I said, we've made some incredible progress in certain areas, preparing for extreme heat. And certainly this summer, I think we felt that, literally. I know in the city of Boston, I don't think we had an inch of rain all summer long. And it's, you know, 2 years ago, we had the nor'easters and the snow, 10 feet of snow. So when you really think about, if anyone wants to question climate change, just look at the weather patterns in the city of Boston. And in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the change, the drastic change. We go from the winter of 2014, which we had 10 feet of snow, to the winter of 2015, where we had very little snow, to the summer of 2016, where we had nearly zero rain. And in the fall that we're having, we have days of in the 40s and 30s. And then we also have days in the 60s and 70s. So it really, there's something going on out there. So we're also working on preparing for flooding, developing common understanding of the risks of the climate change. In Boston, and Austin Blackman's here with us today, the chief of the environment for the city of Boston. We're about to release the Climate Ready Boston report, which includes updates on projections for climate change in our city, identifies which neighborhoods and which populations are most vulnerable, and it proposes specific ways that we can be more resilient of the changes ahead that we have to be prepared for, something that's really important. The report shows us that in the next century, the sea level rise in Boston will be at least 3 feet higher. And I think we had a little taste of that over the last 2.5 nights in the city with the rising tide. And one of those areas is down on the waterfront, Christopher Columbus Park, where there's a seawall there. And if you go there today, you look over the side, there's about 4 feet from the top of the sea, from the surface of the ocean to the top of the wall. Two nights ago, that was coming over the wall. Which is, if we had, you throw on top of that, a nor'easter or a hurricane, you can just imagine and see what the damage would be in our city. 18% of Boston's land is going to be exposed to floods. 12,000 of our existing buildings could be exposed to floods. These climate-ready Boston findings fully inform the Imagine Boston 2030 project that we're doing, and we're going to be releasing a draft today of that plan. So we're talking about this in our plan. It's the first citywide plan in over 50 years. This year, Boston received a grant from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to address flood pathways in East Boston and Charlestown. I expect similar examples to follow as we continue to work together. Clearly, this is a very crucial moment for the entire coalition. We've worked hard to build a strong network of people, and we've built tremendous momentum. We want to continue to see that momentum move forward. This is also a crucial moment because, as we talked about earlier, the federal funding and the administration, we're not sure exactly what's going to happen to the climate, but we do know that in Boston, the environment touches every single aspect of life in our city. For us, climate policy is about protecting our shorelines, it's about creating jobs, and it's also about getting people to work more efficiently. Climate action will always be a top priority as long as it affects the people of Boston. We are ready to work with the federal government on these issues, and I think as a coalition, we're certainly eager to work with the federal government on these issues because it's not just about Boston. Our plan certainly is focused on Boston, Climate Ready Boston, but what we're doing today is we're making sure that we look as a coalition, as a region, on how we move forward. So we're going to continue to work with our partners. I'm getting a new microphone, hold on.
Let's try.
Let's see how this works. We're going to continue to work with our partners because it's critically important. So I just want to say I look forward to working collaboratively together. Even in the face of uncertainty, Boston, our neighbors are leading by example, driving a bold, low-carbon agenda. The city of Boston has built energy reporting and disclosure ordinances for large buildings and institutions, Renew Boston is reaching out to our neighborhoods throughout the city with a message of energy efficiency, and we're not stopping there. So this is what I mean by carrying the torch. I'm a proud member of this network, and I want to thank all of the great partners at this table for the great work you do, and I look forward to keeping our momentum going. So I hope you enjoy the morning.
I'll use a bad mic. So now I want to introduce our next speaker and our great partner on the state level. He is representing, Secretary Beaton is not only representing EOEA today, but representing really the governor and a number of other cabinet agencies who we work closely with, certainly MassDOT, Public Safety and Security, and a variety of others on climate change issues. Secretary Beaton.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you all very much for the opportunity to be here with you. And thank you all to all of you mayors and to everyone at this table. It is through your partnerships that we are able to accomplish such great things that what we are here to talk about today. And without your leadership, we couldn't do it on the state level. So thanks to all of you very much. Thank you to Mayor Curtatone for your leadership in this initiative. And thank you to Mayor Walsh for your continued partnership and friendship, and for building such a great team for dealing with these issues, like Austin and the rest of his team, because their leadership is makes our job so much easier to be able to work with such partners, because it really is a collaborative approach to dealing with these issues, and the folks that you have all put in place to lead these initiatives in your own cities has really been remarkable and has made, quite honestly, our lives a heck of a lot easier. So thank you all very much. It is a great pleasure to be here on behalf of Governor Baker and Lieutenant Governor Polito. I think back to a year ago, which was the first sort of kickoff of the mayor's dealing with this climate preparedness issue, and to look where we've come in the last year, both in the individual level, what we're going to hear more from the cities, have things happening in each individual city and the collaboration that is occurring, and then things that we're being able to have accomplished in the last year. On the state side, it's really been an amazing year for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Two main elements that we have been incredibly focused on that I actually talked about last gathering about a year ago. It is no secret that Governor Baker, when coming into office, was keenly focused on passing energy legislation. We have some of the most aggressive greenhouse gas reduction goals in all of the United States. And we need to be very proactive and very aggressive in how we meet those goals. And Governor Baker assessed that, looked at that in the early days of his administration and said, we need to go after this. This is a top priority, and let's try to get some legislation done to make sure that we meet those goals under the Global Warming Solutions Act. And sure enough, earlier this summer in August, Governor Baker signed into law that very piece of energy legislation that we discussed that authorizes a procurement of 1,600 megawatts of offshore wind and a large-scale import of 1,200 megawatts of hydro and Class 1 RPS and or Class 1 RPS eligible resources to make sure that we have delivery of clean, reliable, dispatchable, affordable energy long-term for the Commonwealth. So a very great success that is going to be go a very long way in us meeting our goals in dealing with the mitigation side of the climate issues, in reducing our contribution as a Commonwealth to a warming climate. Because as the mayor highlighted, there's no question, I don't think anyone sitting in this room would deny that something is happening, exactly like what the mayor said. The intensity of the storms, the frequency of storms, the volatility of the storms, and the extremes that we're seeing. And maybe it's due to Governor Baker and Mayor Walsh being elected. Maybe you guys have a dark cloud hanging over your heads or something. I don't know what's going on. But if you actually think of think of the extremes on either end, from the snow to the drought and everything in between that we have seen, it has been unprecedented, certainly in my lifetime. So we recognize that. We understand that. And now is the time for us to come together, to collaborate, to share information, to share data, to leverage the amazing institutions that we look out upon here throughout the entire Commonwealth. And we are poised to be not only a national leader, but a world leader in dealing with these issues. And we have been, and we will continue to be. And it is moments like this and gatherings like this where we come forward and have the commitment in a regional way and address the fact that we can't do it individually in our own silos. We have to work together. It's something that, quite honestly, doesn't exist in other parts of the country. And it, again, is once again showing that we are a model leader for the rest of the nation. And seeing all of the great work that is happening individually in the various cities, but then the collaborative work, fits in perfectly with another one of Governor Baker's key initiatives in the signing of Executive Order 569 and Executive Order relative to climate adaptation and resiliency. Governor Baker has worked into the budget and created a new position for a climate change director, and we are graced with her presence here today, Katie Theoharides, from our office. And Katie, good luck to you, because you got a lot of work ahead of you. We have a very aggressive agenda set forth in Governor Baker's Climate EO. We are going to work within our own state asset portfolio. We have climate change directors assigned in each secretariat, in each ESO. Every representative within the cabinet has a member that is going to work very closely with Katie and our partners at the Executive Office of Public Safety, as Secretary Bennett and I will be chairing this initiative. And we're going to work very closely amongst each other to do an asset inventory and to develop a climate preparedness plan and an adaptation plan statewide for our, you know, in our own state asset portfolio. And on top of that, we are in the works. We're still in the early stages of this. It's only been a couple of months since we got it signed, so more great news to come. But we're going to be working very intensely on a municipal element, our MVP program, that is going to be a key initiative that allows us to work closely with municipalities to do vulnerability assessments in each municipality, provide technical assistance, and make sure that we are providing the support to the municipalities to make sure that we aren't operating in individual silos, and that the information and the data we're all collecting can be collaborated, put together, and we can create a statewide strategy towards dealing with this climate change adaptation that we clearly see on a day-to-day basis. So a lot more on that to come, a lot more work is ahead of us, but thanks to your leadership, the ball is already rolling. Certainly in the most populous part of the state, you've already taken great leadership and initiative in that. And on behalf of Governor Baker and Lieutenant Governor Polito, we thank you for your leadership. We thank you for your continued commitment. And we very much look forward to working with all of you in the years ahead. Thank you.
Secretary, thank you very much for those words. We really appreciate it. We really appreciate your presence here today. And Katie's presence and the consistent work that we've had with all of your staff. We are in contact with the OEEA, it seems like every day, on one thing or another in regard to the work of this task force, and it's very helpful to have their active engagement. Thank you, Secretary. It is now my pleasure to introduce Kirk Bosma from the Woods Hole Group. Where is Kirk? There it is. Kirk, why don't you go up there and just stand there while I talk about you a little bit. Kirk is one of the folks that we've been working with actively and has been so just really put so much effort into the work of sort of day-to-day trying to figure out how we can bring good science, how we can bring good data to the policy work that we're doing in climate change. And a lot of that is trying to figure out ways to make sure everyone's on the same page, to unify the use of data, to try and get our projections to be reasonably similar to one another, to talk back and forth in the same language. And what Kirk is going to talk about today is the issue of how we translate from climate modeling to actual planning and implementation. We do a lot of modeling at MAPC. I employ a lot of modelers. I do not typically understand the work they do, but I do want to find a way to translate it into our plans and then, most importantly, to our implementation. So Kirk is going to lead us through a discussion of that. It's a pleasure to have you here today. Kirk Bosma.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me. I'd like to start by just thanking everybody in this room, right? So from my perspective as a scientist engineer, I'm looking at what Boston and the state of Massachusetts is doing. And Boston and the state are really leading the way here on a national level. This type of science and the type of applications we're applying to understand this stuff really does lead the national way from my perspective as a scientist. So kudos to everybody in the room on that front. I've been fortunate enough to work with a lot of communities on, primarily from my perspective, sea level rise, extreme storms, increased precipitation, so from a flooding perspective. And typically where that starts is the community is saying, well, where do I start, right? The media has created a lot of situations where flooding is projected to show everything underwater, right? So how you adapt and build resiliency to that is an overwhelming experience to a lot of communities. And this happened from Mass DOT to the City of Boston to Partners Healthcare Group, where they really needed to better understand where to go and how to really adjust to this. So I did have a little handout. This is like a 4-sheet handout with some information on there that we'll kind of walk through. I'm not proficient enough in speaking to be able to explain this without some graphics, so that's why you have those. So the first sheet there basically is the results of a hydrodynamic wave model that was developed at Woods Hole Group for the Mass DOT Federal Highway Administration project. It is what the City of Boston is using, it is what Partners Healthcare is using, and Massport's using. And it's a little bit different than what you typically see in terms of a flood map. It's not just based on water's gonna go up 3 feet, and so whatever is under that's gonna get wet. This actually dynamically models the storm events, changing global climate and ocean temperature, how tropical and extratropical storms are gonna influence the city. And so when Mass DOT originally started looking at this, they're like, where do we start? We have hundreds of assets, a central artery, so on and so forth. So this type of mapping provides an ability to basically start prioritizing and identifying where do we really have to direct our funds? How do we really start to address the flooding potential due to climate change and sea level rise? So if you look at these maps, it goes from kind of the present day down to 2070. The key thing I wanted to just mention here is that color scales you see over there is its inundation probability. So instead of just saying, hey, you're wet or you're not wet, you basically get a distribution of percentages of the probability you're gonna get wet when a storm rolls through. So focusing on that East Boston area there, you can see at present day, there's about a 1-2% chance. So that's about once every 100 years, every 50 years, you're gonna get an event that's gonna basically flood that area. If you jump to that same location in 2030, you're now at 5-10% in some areas, meaning you're once every 10, every 20 years. In 2070, it's at 50%. It's every other year you can expect to get wet. So this is really valuable from a community and stakeholder perspective because they can look at this and start to gauge not only where the flooding's gonna be, but what my tolerance level is for my specific assets, buildings, natural resources throughout the community. So it really provides that ability. If you go to the next page, just a couple of examples from Hingham, Massachusetts, and also from Chelsea, where you can see how that probability distribution starts to get applied to your actual important infrastructure. So in Hingham, which is the top figure there, it's all these little important dots, pump stations, dams, roadways. At each one of those, you basically get a full distribution of water levels based on your probability of flooding. The way I kind of explain that probability of flooding is, if you wake up in the morning, check the weather, what's the percent chance it's gonna rain? If you look at this map and you're in a 50% chance, probably gonna need an umbrella. In this case, you're probably gonna need hip waders to get through the water. So, but the model then is able to give you this distribution of depth. So from an engineering perspective, a planning perspective, you can start to identify what level do I want to build resiliency to and for. Because of the present day 2030, 2070 shift, you also get kind of a time to act piece of information, right? So how long do I have before that tolerance or that probability becomes overwhelming to me? So why that's so important is because we can't solve all the problems on day one, right? We don't have enough money, right? But if you know how to prioritize and phase things in both from a probabilistic perspective, but also from a time perspective, then you can start to build adaptations. The lower graphic there, Chelsea, shows similar things where you actually are ranking where to prioritize things. Where should you direct your focus first? And that's kind of the power of what we're doing here in Boston. This probabilistic approach isn't happening anywhere else right now. If you go to the next graphic, just demonstrate something a little further, just focused on Chelsea for right now, because they've done some great work. Again, we're going back to that probability distribution map. And so, you know, the previous graphic, we kind of talked about individual sites. But there's also these regional flood pathways. The mayor mentioned, you know, Charlestown and East Boston. Those are two critical pathways. Here's another one in Chelsea. The Island End River, which is on the kind of the lower left there of the figure. And there's a big food distribution network. There's a poster over there regarding that. You can see there's a very critical flood pathway coming into the city of Chelsea and Everett. A couple things you want to point out here is that you'll notice that it's a very directed pathway, right? It's only occurring over a relatively small zone. As you go from present day to 2030 to 2070, that entry point of flooding isn't really expanding, right? Now the flood levels and flood depths and the flood extents inland of that are getting worse, right? They're expanding, but the water isn't coming in from new areas. So what does that tell me? Does that tell me I need to build a big seawall around the whole city? No. Right? Do I need to provide some, you know, connection to the islands offshore? No. I can do a very cost-effective solution at a very targeted location that provides resilience both today and going into the future, because that flood pathway doesn't really grow that much, right? And there's these types of things happening all over the city, right? So, you know, the idea that, you know, we're going to have to build a huge wall around the whole thing, you know, we'll see what these projections really show. That if anything, the latest election shows the polls and projections aren't really the greatest things in the world. So we can kind of wait to see what happens in this climate change perspective, right? So I would emphasize, you know, from this Chelsea perspective, and this is one of many, and we found these in Boston as well, that there's very targeted site-specific remediation options that communities can do that don't cost millions and billions of dollars, and they will work. So the final graphic I'll share is just, you know, taking this to conclusion. This is what's happening, and we're proposing this Island End River. And again, it's a unique mix of, you know, we're talking about an urban environment, right? Chelsea, we've got oil tank companies, we've got everything down there. But what we're designing and proposing here is a mix of green, gray, and type hybrid infrastructure. So if you look at this plan, we have a living shoreline along a certain extent. We have a natural berm as opposed to a hardened seawall. We have a salt marsh restoration project. There's an extension of a boardwalk that's actually going to connect the public to, you know, the natural resources of salt marsh further to the south to a park that exists in the area. And so kind of connecting the community to the coastline in an urban environment. And then there's even, currently there's an outfall in that location right now. So we also designed a stormwater BMP 4 bay to basically collect stormwater, let that filter out to hopefully improve water quality, send that through the salt marsh, which is a great filter for some of this stuff. So this kind of comprehensive solution, which again, isn't, you know, going to break the bank, involves, you know, green infrastructure through salt marsh restoration, living shoreline work, natural berms. There is that purple line there, a seawall extension to basically provide a second line of defense against some more of the extreme storms. But it's these type of solutions that really make a lot of sense in an urban environment. And these type of things also we're talking about applying in Charlestown and in East Boston. So it was kind of a whirlwind view of taking it from this really highly technical model all the way down to like actual planning. But the city and the state's doing a great job of getting there. MassDOT has done some wonderful stuff to build resiliency to the central artery system. Massport has really done a lot of great work on making sure that the transportation network from their perspective is resilient. The hospitals have been great in making sure they're resilient. And then even at a community scale, communities are really working hard to build resiliency, and what we've been able to find is you can do this, without building the wall around the whole city. So thanks for your time.
Kirk Bosma, thank you very, very much. We really appreciate it. I appreciate the information. I appreciate particularly that detailed plan at the end, because that sort of says something about the work that, can you all hear me? Yes. That really says something about the work we're all doing. Because the purpose of this effort is not just to do the numbers, although that's part of it, because we want to be using the same numbers, and we want to have a clear understanding of what's likely to happen, what's going to happen, but what the likelihood is within a range. We also want to be able to figure out what are the steps we're going to be able to take to confront the challenges that we're having. And when Kirk and the other folks that he's working with can look at, for example, the food centers in Chelsea and Everett and actually say, okay, here's the risk, but now here are the steps that can actually be taken to deal with it. Here's what they cost. Here's a pattern of time that we can use to a period of time that we can use to actually address them. First do the first one, then do the second one, then do the third one. That's what resilience is all about. That's what makes it more than a word. We use these words, you know, they start off, they're fresh, they're new, resilience, sustainability, all of that stuff. And then they get a little tired after a few years. And we have to remind ourselves what backs them up is what really counts. It's what are we doing? What are we changing the codes? Are we building in a different way? Are we putting up defenses? Are we dealing with various efforts, not only on the mitigation side, but also on the adaptation side? So we are going to have a little panel where, let's see, Mayor Burke from Medford, Mayor Warren from Newton, and City Manager Ambrosino from Chelsea are all going to talk about some of the individual things that they are doing within their communities. But before we do that, I have a couple of things that I'd like to say. My purpose here is to explain a little bit about the task force's priorities over the course of the last 18 months, just a little bit about what we've accomplished, what our priorities are going forward into 2017, because those priorities were adopted by the mayors either at their last meeting or the meeting before that. I'm not quite sure which one. But I also want to start with just a few acknowledgments, which are really critical. First of all of the work that we do with the Metro Mayors Coalition would not be possible without the support of the broader family of MAPC, and I'm pleased to have my boss here today, who I'd like to introduce in this Boston setting, Keith Bergman, who's the town manager from Littleton, is currently the president of MAPC. Thank you very much, Keith, for being with us here today. There are too many members of my staff for me to introduce them, but I'd like to ask the members of the MAPC staff who worked on putting this event together, but more importantly, work on climate change issues, to stand, and just for people to acknowledge you for your efforts, if you could, please. And it's a little bit of a fun story. I will mention one staff person who is not here, who really is the moving force behind the climate change task force, and probably did more work than anyone else, although everybody worked hard to put this event together, and her name is Axum Tefera. So Axum was in the office working until very late yesterday on this, right before she had to go from the office to Logan Airport to get on a plane to Morocco, where she is representing young climate change professionals from the United States at the World Climate Change Conference that's taking place in Morocco. And I really feel that's emblematic, symbolic of the tremendous people, not just at MAPC, but all of our staffs that are working on this issue and bring their heart and soul and minds into this effort. And if we look a little beyond MAPC to the task force itself, the task force involves the staff people that have been appointed by their mayors and managers to work on these issues. And the only things that those people have to do are, you know, their bosses look at them and say, hey, you take care of climate change, okay? That's all they have to do, really. So I would like all the members of the task force to stand and receive our acknowledgments and thanks, please. Lastly, I just want to say that it does take money. And, you know, in addition to the local funding, which has been contributed either to individual projects or the money each year that I think it's $10,000 a year that members of the Metro Mayors Coalition pay into the coalition budget. I also want to say that, you know, a tremendous amount of our ability to address these issues depends on three other critical sources of funding. First of all, one of Governor Baker and Lieutenant Governor Polito's signature programs, the Community Compact, which funds a great deal of this work. The District Local Technical Assistance Program, or what we affectionately just call DLTA, because it's a really bizarre name, DLTA, which is a state-appropriated program that enables regional planning agencies to provide technical support to cities and towns. And then, of course, our foundation partners, particularly the Barr Foundation, which is represented here today by Bud Riss and also by Mariela Puerto, who are both here today. And I know that Jim Canales and Mary Skelton Roberts would have been here but had other engagements and couldn't join us as well. So to Bud and Mariela, thank you so much for your support and assistance. So what are some of the things that we've been working on? Overview, we have had three critical priorities this year. The first is local capacity building. There are some communities in our region, and be no surprise who, that, you know, because they're larger, and they've been doing this for a longer period of time. They have excellent, capable, wonderful staff who are working on these issues. But then among the Metro Mayors communities, and certainly more broadly throughout MAPC, there are smaller communities where if they're lucky, there's one person focused on these issues. So when we all came together and the mayor signed their commitment a year and a half ago, one of the real focuses, I would almost say the number one focus, was to get these folks together and provide capacity building and cross-fertilization among the cities and towns so that they could learn from each other, learn from national experts, and learn the latest data and strategies that were available to deal with climate change. We have had brown bags, we've had working groups like the Data Working Group, we have held conferences here in Boston and sent people to conferences elsewhere in the United States. We are constantly bringing people in to talk about the latest and greatest ideas of dealing with these issues. And that capacity building has really been a tremendous part of the task force's work. One of the things we've also been doing is focusing on vulnerability assessments. The very first thing a community needs to do is to figure out where the vulnerabilities are. And as you'll hear from some of the speakers, several of those vulnerability assessments have been completed, and recommendations are now underway and moving toward implementation, even though it's a long and somewhat slow process, can be costly. And others are beginning. Our goal is that hopefully by the end of, by the next time we meet, we will have vulnerability assessments completed, I hope, in all of the Metro Mayors communities. And you folks should know that we are working on them, either for individual communities or jointly groups of communities, like our Magic Subregion, for example, where Keith participates. We are working on these vulnerability assessments throughout the MAPC region. And we have great support from EOEA, particularly in this endeavor, and I know we're engaged in ongoing conversations with the administration about how to support and get these things done and get a statewide vulnerability assessment completed, because everyone in the state level and in all the regional planning agencies and in Massachusetts understand the critical importance of this work. Another area that we decided to focus on a little more from a policy perspective is heat island impact. We can face, you know, people talk a lot about flooding, and I will talk a little bit more about that as well, and coastal issues, but climate change is not only on the coasts. Climate change is also at heat islands in locations throughout the region where, you know, when I was growing up, maybe we had a day or two in the summer over 90. But if you think that, you know, you are perhaps an elderly person living on the third floor of a public housing development, and all of a sudden it's 90 degrees, 8 days in a row, that's a little bit of a different situation. So we have been working with the Trust for Public Land on both a modeling side and then an implementation recommendation side. I think that Darcy and Kevin are here, is that right, from Trust for Public Land, to figure out ways in which we can deal with green infrastructure and cool some of these areas down. Members of my staff have developed a Keep Cool app that helps people during hot times in the summer to figure out where they can go to get relief and how they can get relief. And this is going to be an ongoing focus as we move forward. Another area that we're focused on, of course, is flooding. Coastal flooding and riverine flooding, whether it be the Charles, the Mystic, the Neponset, et cetera. And in this area, we've looked at critical infrastructure. One of those critical infrastructure areas, for example, as Kirk mentioned earlier, is the food distribution centers in Chelsea and Everett. We do not want to have a situation where those are going to have to shut down in the event of a severe storm event. We are also very concerned about the dams and making sure that they can be modernized and up to date and protect everything that we have in this region, the Amelia Earhart Dam, the Charles River Dam, et cetera. We have not yet focused on that quite as much as we would like to. We are in the process of trying to establish an ongoing partnership with the state on the review and analysis of those dams and what the future may hold to make those somewhat old facilities really modern and up to date and capable of dealing with some of the issues that we have going forward. One policy item that we are going to add this year, and it's going to be talked about at a subsequent panel that Rebecca Davis will facilitate, is the question of infrastructure, broadly put, because some of our infrastructure is publicly owned and operated, some of it is owned by public utilities, some of it is owned and operated essentially privately, but we need a better conversation among all the owners and operators of infrastructure to make sure that that infrastructure can withstand the impacts of climate change and that we are coordinating our efforts to bring that into the 21st century and to recognize the impacts that climate change are likely to have. So that is the one big priority area that we decided to add in 2017 while we continue to work on capacity building, on flooding, on heat islands, and the various other critical issues that we're focused on in this effort. So with that, I would like to call upon the representatives of our three communities to speak about some of the specific efforts ongoing in their communities. And if they wish to come up here, that's fine, or else we will pass a mic to them. I think we're going to start with Mayor Warren from Newton, who's joined us. Seti, please.
Thank you, Mark, very much, and your staff for supporting us and leading us. And I also want to acknowledge Mayor Walsh and the work of his staff, his leadership, and Mayor Curtatone. Thank you very much for leading us. I'll just be very brief and hit some points over the last year since we were together around our commitment on climate change mitigation. I think it's fair to say in Newton what we attempted to do, and I think we've done somewhat successfully, is weave in the commitments that we signed last year to the work we're doing and how people live, where they're housed, how they move around as far as transportation, and how they deal with energy costs, their bottom line. I think it's fair to say we've incorporated a lot of the commitments that we made last year and the commitments we'll make next year into the various areas I'm gonna go through. This year, Newton produced the first of its kind housing strategy to address affordable housing, mixed income housing. In June, we made that public, and we incorporated a lot of the principles around how to build green, how to incorporate transit-oriented development in the sites we identified for affordable housing across the city. One of the flagship places that we're really excited about is 27 acres in Newton, on the south side of Newton, bordering Needham, where we've identified an area where we're going to work with the developer to create middle-income housing, as well as walkable, bikeable spaces, and open spaces as well. So we're really excited about that. We have 70 locations throughout the city where we think we can add additional density. Second is our transportation strategy that we announced 2 months ago that will expand biking, walking, and multimodal transit through shared ride. Get people off the streets. We're going to aggressively move ahead with charging stations, adding charging stations connected to solar in our city. We have some concrete plans around that in our transportation strategy in the next 18 months. Third, we are expanding our solar program. We announced a solar share program that will give solar credits to low-income residents in our city. We're sharing solar credits from our municipal sites. We worked very closely with Eversource and ABCD to launch that program about a month ago. Fourth, we are, in the next 3 to 4 months, are announcing mapping using GIS of locations where gas leaks are located in the city. We know that's a contributor to climate change, and we've identified those areas. We look forward to putting forth a mitigation plan. And lastly, we are fortunate enough that we're at this area where we're announcing substantial amount of investment as far as money and resource over the next 10 years in Newton to do roadway sidewalk construction so that we can actually work on this infrastructure using the principles. We're we're going to be doing three times more work as far as investment and resource over the next 10 years in Newton because of our financial position. $93 million over the next 10 years we will have available to decrease traffic congestion through signalization, add options around walking and biking, improving our water systems as well, and invest in climate preparedness. So those are the items. Looking forward to signing. I think I may have missed the official signing a little earlier. Oh, I did not. Okay, good. I'm looking forward to signing this year so we can continue the work that we're doing. Thank you.
Next, it's my pleasure to introduce Mayor Burke from the City of Medford.
Thank you very much, Mark. Good morning, everybody. Secretary Beaton, Mayor, City Managers, and all of you for coming. We all realize that cities and towns across our state are on the front lines of climate change, and I stand here today to say that Medford is concerned about the effects that climate change has on our community, our region, and our world. This year, we have been working to better understand our specific vulnerabilities. We're pleased to have assistance from neighboring universities such as MIT and Tufts University to move our work forward. But in addition, the collaboration and support we have received from our communities on the task force has been extremely beneficial. In particular, we appreciate the guidance that both Somerville and Cambridge have offered to us, allowing us to sit in on their meetings and share their data with us. The Metro Mayor's collaboration has greatly enhanced our ability to understand the expected climate impacts on Medford and the region in an efficient and cost-effective manner. As Mark just mentioned, capacity building is such a huge thing, and you have definitely allowed us to do that with our small staff. We're one of the communities that has a very small staff, so we appreciate the efforts that everyone has made to include us in on this process and sharing their information. I had other comments, but Mark has mentioned several of them. So just a few months ago, we had the privilege of taking a boat tour on the Mystic River, and it was eye-opening to see the impact that area has not only on Chelsea, but our entire region and our food supply. You know, it's very concerning, and we need to pay attention to this for all the local infrastructure, our businesses, and our natural resources. They are all impacted by this change. It's a real, real trend with real effects that will impact our residents and businesses. And it's important that we are working collaboratively to do our part to both reduce our carbon footprint and mitigate the effects that climate change has in our area. I'm pleased that Medford will be receiving this technical assistance from the MAPC and the Trust for Public Lands. I thank you very much for that, to help our staff to use the mapping tools to prioritize our efforts for mitigation and adaptation. This tool allows us to have real conversations with developers that are coming into our city so that we can do things right. And not only developers, but for our own processes. We're looking at a new police station in Medford, and these mapping tools are guiding us as to where we should locate our police station, and if we are in a vulnerable area, how we should do it smartly so that we're protecting this infrastructure, this resource for our community in the years to come and not being short-sighted in where we place this structure. There are several locations that are impacted by these changes, and in particular, Mystic Avenue in the South Medford area of our city. It's very low-lying, adjacent to the Mystic River and Route 93, so we really need to pay attention. And Alicia from our city is here today. She serves on this task force, and we've done a lot of work to analyze the impact specifically in that area, which we know is in harm's way. While we're aware that the area could benefit from more trees, planted areas, and green stormwater infrastructure, this partnership will help us craft fact-based policies around this green infrastructure. This in turn will provide us with detailed information that we can use in all of our conversations. We are very excited to continue our collaboration with the Metro Mayor's Task Force and appreciate the support provided by MAPC to bring a united voice to this important issue. By signing this mitigation compact here this morning, we are demonstrating our commitment to our environment. Thank you very much.
Now we have. Thank you very much, Mayor. And now Tom Ambrosino
the former mayor of Revere, but currently the city manager in Chelsea, Tom.
Thanks, Mark. So what we've done in Chelsea over the last year, I think since the last time this group met, is really focus on our areas of vulnerability and really try to think about concrete solutions to addressing the problem. And I think the lesson that we've drawn is that the more we study in a scientific way the issue, the less daunting the problem has become. So instead of thinking, oh, in 50 years the city's going to be underwater, we need to build a giant wall, like some others suggest, we are actually looking and saying, you know what, this problem is not quite as difficult as we thought. There are some cost-effective solutions to mitigating this problem, and the island and river issue that Kurt brought up is a great example of that. So this food distribution center is an extremely vulnerable area to flooding. We saw that firsthand. We took this boat tour. Yet, the flooding really is all coming in from one source point, and there are actually effective ways that are not incredibly expensive to address the problem. And working with scientists from Woods Hole and others, we now are starting to at least put some pen to paper and figure out, okay, what exactly is this cost? Because our next step really is to go to the legislature, go to the state, and say, we have this real vulnerability, but we also have a cost-effective way to deal with it. And if we can do that in these other areas and in other cities, and I really think we can. I mean, certainly not every vulnerability is gonna have a neat, clean solution, but many of them might, and the more we study that, the more we're gonna be able to sort out which ones do, and at least start to make concrete steps to attacking this problem. So as Mark said, we stopped moving away from the theoretical problem and more to sort of concrete solutions. And I think that is the goal of this group. So I'm happy to play a part. I'm grateful for the support all the other members of the Metro Mayors Coalition have given to Chelsea, and I look forward to good things in the future.
Thank you, Seti and Stephanie and Tom. We appreciate your comments and your detail. The next panel, our final panel before we talk about the commitment, will focus on that additional new priority, the coordinated infrastructure priority. And to facilitate that, I want to introduce my right hand at MAPC, my wonderful Deputy Director, Rebecca Davis. Rebecca.
Thanks, Mark. So in setting priorities for the upcoming year, I think what the task force has really recognized is that there are many pieces of critical infrastructure that aren't controlled by cities and towns. Our transportation, our energy, our water and sewer, and our telecommunications infrastructure is all critical to keep our residents prepared for climate. And we need to engage our federal, regional, private sector, and state partners in order to collectively understand what our vulnerabilities are and leverage opportunities to jointly work on adaptation projects. And so in the year forward, we look forward to figuring out how can we better coordinate and work together. And in order to have that conversation, we're gonna hear from some of our partners, as well as some of our cities and towns, to think about what could that coordination look like, as well as to hear about ongoing efforts that currently exist. So first, I have the pleasure to introduce Fred Lasky from the MWRA.
Check. Always count on the guy from Winthrop to bail us out. I just to go off the script a minute, I did ask Mark if I could do this. Our MWRA advisory board.
Nobody asked me if they can go off script.
We're going to go for it anyway. Our advisory board that represents 60 communities that we serve is holding an offsite, morning long offsite on water redundancy at Boston College in early December. So there's a flyer here. And I'd really urge you folks and you mayors to take send some people to this. It's a very important strategic decision, perhaps a once in a generation decision. At the MWRA, as you know, we are the wholesalers of water and wastewater for much of the metropolitan Boston area. We have our top priority is to keep our system running. and I'm going to talk about that, but I would also just touch quickly on that we have really done a lot on the alternative energy. We've done a lot on reducing our carbon footprint. We gave a presentation to our board of directors yesterday that really, and I don't mean to brag, but the folks who work there have really put us in a position of national leadership as a water and wastewater utility as far as alternative energy goes, as far as reducing our carbon footprint in energy audits, those kinds of things. But day in and day out, our priority is to keep our water and our wastewater systems running, because there are 60 communities, 2.5 million people depend on our system running, because if our system doesn't run, the local system doesn't run, and it all goes to hell in a handbasket in a very quick way. On the water side, we're in good shape in that we have massive storage capacity out of Quavon. We do not have many facilities in the floodplain, or any really, and so we basically have the ability to store the massive snow melt that Mayor Walsh mentioned and those type things, and use it as we need it. And right now, Cambridge, Lynn, Burlington are on, Worcester is on, Peabody's taking a lot of water from us. So in a regional sense, we're there, we're the belt and suspenders. And we have others who have come on. I do something that Secretary Beaton did yesterday. Does anyone know where the Cherry Hill Water District is, or the Rochdale? The Rochdale? One guy. Town of Leicester. We approved yesterday the town of Leicester, which is just to the west of Worcester, to come on. So we are really having a statewide impact at this point. So on the water side, we're in great shape. The wastewater side is a little bit different in that we have, we're taking a pragmatic approach. 100-year storm plus 2.5 feet is what our inundation maps were running. And we have roughly 20 facilities in the floodplain from the wastewater side. And on average, we rehabilitate our stations about once every 20 years. So as we go forward, the board of directors under the leadership of Secretary Beaton and Mr. Blackman down the end has created a policy for the staff that any major rehabilitation that goes on in our facilities is going to take into account sea rise. And the first of those two projects is currently underway. The work is underway. The Alloy pump station up on Route 16, which takes flows from Cambridge and Somerville and Arlington, is being upgraded, and we're doing all the things necessary to protect that station, raising up all the electrical computer stuff, stop logs, berms, protecting the pumps. And the second major one is the Chelsea Headworks, which takes all the flow from north of the city, and that's about a $60 million, $70 million rehab. And that also includes updating and protecting both that station from sea rise. It literally is on the shore of the Chelsea Creek. And those items, frankly, as Mr. Ambrosino said, some of it's not that expensive. I think the Alloy station was under $500,000 to add it. And beyond that, we are doing things just on our own, with our own staff, whether it be stop logs, protecting things as we go. So the work is underway. We continue to make progress on that thing. And the last thing I would say that is critically important to us is that MWRA staff has a very close working relationship with our member communities. And when it hits the fan and the storms, we all work together. And that's critically important, whether it be the folks of Newton, whether it be Commissioner Cody over in Somerville, Kane, we all work together. And I think that's the important thing, that there is that communication back and forth and the ability to deal with things, whether we have put a lot of steroids in our pumping capacity, our mobile pumping capacity, so we can assess our member communities. So with that, I'll cut it short, and I thank you again for hosting us.
Fred, next. Next, we have our co-chair of our coalition, our vice chair, excuse me, Mayor Dolan from Melrose.
Thank you. So Jim and I are here at the end of the table, Melrose and Winthrop. Melrose is a city of 28,000 people. We have 15 houses of worship. We're 96% residential. We have 2 golf courses and a hospital. So what role do we play in this massive organization that's the hub, right? The hub of Massachusetts? Well, it'd be easy for me to say that we, Jim and I, are gonna utilize the incredible leadership of Mayor Walsh and his staff, which are the best in the United States of America, to help solve this problem, and we do. But that's not how it works. We could look to my right and say we can have Cambridge pay for it because we know they have the money. and we do that. But that's not how it works either. Or we could go to Mayor Curtatone and hope that just through his blunt force of personality, he could stop global warming. And we still hope and his staff's incredible also, but that's not how it works. So how can small communities play a role in this? And they have to. Because we have an operational obligation, and I would argue a moral obligation, whether you're Melrose or Winthrop or Littleton, to get in this game. In Melrose 2 years ago, we, as all of us, have had incredibly tough budget times. And the only staff person we hired, new staff person in the whole city, when we needed 10 more teachers and 3 more police officers, we hired a climate and energy efficiency coordinator. City Council voted for it unanimously, and the people supported it, despite cries from all sectors that they needed more. And what have we seen in Melrose? We have seen the incredible increase in coordination, not only with our neighbors on the Metropolitan Mayor's Coalition, and our great friend Fred Lasky at the MWRA, and our business partners. But we have seen grants and support from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and the MAPC. We have seen regional coordinated growth that is not only happening in South Boston and Assembly Square, but in the suburbs of Massachusetts that are affecting the infrastructure and how we all interrelate. We have seen increased flood mapping that has saved taxpayers' dollars in terms of flood insurance. We have seen leaner operation, better transportation policy, energy policy, master planning, in smaller communities that usually don't have any of those things, or those things at a very limited basis. We have seen coordination and education with our schools, educating parents and children about the issues that we face, spreading the good word, and educating private businesses and not-for-profits and houses of worship on how they can do things better. Now, what's happening from that? Now, because of the great work done by Mayor Walsh and Joe Curtatone and Seti Warren, all the people at this table, in the hubs, in the outer urban core, they are looking to Melrose in Stoneham, in Wakefield, in Winchester, in Burlington, all the way up the 128 belt, and never thought in a million years that a climate change coordinator is something that a small suburban town not only could think about, but should have. And it's happening. So the good word that was started here is now spreading across the Commonwealth, and that smaller communities can be part of the solution and must be part of the solution through greater coordinated efforts. And I'm very proud to be a part of it. So thank you for the invitation.
From a small community to a big community, next we're going to hear from Austin Blackman from the city of Boston. And first, I just want to thank Austin and the rest of his staff, Carl and Mia. They have been such active participants in the task force and really have lent their expertise to all of the communities sitting around the table. So Austin, thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. Very kind introduction, but really all the thanks is deserving of the mayor sitting around this table for enabling the work that we do. And that's been touched on quite a bit, and I really want to focus more of my remarks on some of the partnerships that we have as a result of the partnership that we have here at the table. You know, the work of our cities is enabled not only by the state and the great work at EEA and helping the city of Boston with grants for Climate Ready Boston and many other things, but what Boston does is not possible without the work of the people around this table as well. But furthermore, if you think of Climate Ready Boston and the work that we're doing on that initiative, it really is heavily dependent on the utilities that touch all the towns around this table. If we didn't have data and the partnership with the Massachusetts Water Resources Authority, without the data from Eversource, our electric utility, or National Grid, all of these infrastructure partners that touch all of our communities, we would have a very, very incomplete series of analyses. Without their partnership, without their data, without their advice, and their continued partnership, all of this would not be able to be implemented effectively. And so I'm very much looking forward to continuing to work not only with the Metro Mayors Coalition, with the MAPC, but also with our infrastructure partners throughout the metro region to implement Climate Ready Boston and all the mitigation work that Mayor Curtatone is going to talk about and introduce a bit later. So thank you very much.
Next, we're going to hear from Stephen Pike, the CEO from the Mass Clean Energy Center. And I would note the Clean Energy Center is a new agency at this table. I think we've really recognized the importance of energy resiliency and working together to make sure that our energy system is ready for a changing climate. So we're excited to welcome you to the table and to the coalition.
Terrific. Thank you, Rebecca. And thank you, Mark, for all the fantastic work that your organization is doing on climate change and climate change preparedness. Massachusetts Clean Energy Center is, for those of you that don't know, is primarily an economic development agency that's focused on growing the clean energy industry in Massachusetts. I'd say we've been approaching this and will continue to approach this this challenge from a couple of different angles. On one hand, we focus very heavily on technology development. So what are the solutions, the technology solutions to many of the problems that we're trying to tackle? We have a variety of programs that seek to identify those new technologies, those promising technologies, and encourage the development of those. Some specific efforts that we're undertaking with Secretary Beaton's office as well as Commissioner Judson's office at the DOER. Most of you probably know we released a storage study. So that clearly is a technology that could aid climate preparedness quite a bit insofar as it provides tremendous resiliency throughout the system. And it's not just the power system, but if you think about Fred's job and what happens when those pumping stations go down and lose power. You can certainly bring in a generator, but at some point that generator needs to be refueled. And where do you get the fuel? You have to get it out of the ground. You need a pump to do that. So you know, these are some of the technology challenges that we are looking to try to help solve. What that storage study is enabling us to do is to construct a solicitation that will seek to provide funding to demonstration projects throughout the Commonwealth, a variety of what we refer to as use cases, not only providing on the ground resilience to those various use cases, but also informing the policy decisions that the Secretary and Commissioner Judson will need to formulate in the coming years. As you all know, the power markets are far from quote-unquote free markets, and a perfect example is that currently there is no value given to resilience. And that's something that, you know, that the energy regulators need to figure out. What we're hoping these solicitations will demonstrate in part is what are some of the potential models for valuing that resilience. We've also been working on the planning side of things, so on the more macro level of the ledger, and I think a prime example of that is the tremendous work that the City of Boston has done with their community energy study from a couple of years ago. What that did was identify over 40 potential microgrid locations throughout the city. We worked closely with Austin and his team on that, provided some funding as well. Now the next step that we're embarking on is, so that's all well and good, but now we need to take a deeper look at some of those potential microgrid sites. And that's not just in the City of Boston, but that needs to be throughout the Commonwealth. Perhaps a first step in many places, be it Newton or be it Cambridge or elsewhere, is to do a similar study that Boston did to start laying the groundwork for that planning process. So those are efforts that are underway as well. But we want to make very real and tangible progress as well. So we've heard some very some very specific concerns about food distribution. Well, clearly we have concerns about healthcare and hospitals. Oddly enough, and I referred to it before, we have concerns about gas stations. One of the big challenges with when Sandy came through the metropolitan area in New Jersey was that many of these facilities had a backup generator, but that generator only runs for maybe 8 or 10 or 12 hours. It needs to be refueled, as I mentioned before. And then you go to the gas stations and they have no way to get the gas out of the ground. So that's an opportunity that we're looking at as well. But you can also obviously think about fire.
and police. Clearly, Fred has a, you know, a tall task if a big storm comes through, and we need to think about water as well. So what I want to impress upon you is that there are organizations such as ours that are working with the fantastic support of all the folks around this table to address not just the macro problems, which obviously are very real, but also the more micro problems and challenges. And I think that we're making, you know, some admittedly slow, but I will put to you very steady progress on many of those efforts. And I look forward to continuing to work with all of you on that progress and to ensure that it continues in the months and years to come. Thank you.
And finally, we'll hear from Kurt Spalding, the Regional Administrator of EPA Region 1. Under Kurt's leadership, the region has been a real partner with the task force, sitting down every day trying to figure out how they can bring federal resources to help move this effort forward. Thank you, Kurt.
Well, thank you very much, and a little melancholy about all this, obviously, because this indeed will probably be my last opportunity to see all of you, and I want to congratulate all of you. In Region 1, we believe in the idea of building a resilient future for communities in New England. It really begins with the idea that you need to change before change. And you are, as a community, as a group, demonstrating, showing leadership for the whole region and probably the country, as was said earlier, on what resilience can really be about. So again, I'm very pleased about that. Second point, obviously, there's a lot of uncertainty now in the federal side. You alluded to it. I think our core interests will be there and be the same, and our commitment to you will be the same, especially amongst the team in Region 1. And I've been on panels recently with my FEMA counterpart, and there's strong interest in the long run about reducing risk and exposure, because in the end of the day, the federal government ends up being the backstop in many cases related to dealing with emergency response and all the issues that go with it. We have a very strong interest, and will continue to have a strong interest, in dealing with stormwater and its impact to water quality in the area. And it just happens that climate change exacerbates those problems. Cyanobacteria blooms, those kinds of matters, are generally stormwater in cause. And indeed, as we think about solutions to flooding and the kinds of solutions I've heard talked about here, we're very open and want to be part of the conversation about how we build resilience into these solutions around stormwater. We've hopefully built a framework under our new MS4 approach that allows to have those conversations. I was just at a meeting up in New Hampshire where a lot of communities were actually there talking about the new stormwater tools that are coming forward, the planning tools, the analytical tools, the modeling tools. So insofar as you have to integrate everything, I think we have a strong federal interest in helping to do that. And we've done integrated plans in other communities in Massachusetts now, one in Chicopee, one in Worcester. We've integrated these concerns of both water quality, resilience risk, the idea of how do we retrofit our facilities, just as Fred was talking about. Well, what are the priorities? And try to wrap that up into a single plan that meets the federal requirements regarding water quality. We are a leader in that nationally. How we do this integration of traditional fiduciary responsibility and statutory responsibility under our federal statutes, at the same time build resilience, that's something we're very, very committed to. The other thing I think that is very much an opportunity is the power of information. It's fantastic to see the maps and the presentations and the power of the new tools being brought forth, how that connects to community and your constituents and frankly, the new president's constituents, all matter. And we'd like to be helpful as we can. We do have a capacity to integrate information with our own GIS capabilities and look at all those federal pieces to it. And finally, the last interest point I want to bring out that I trust will continue to be a concern is the equity issue as we look at this. It is indeed the case, when you look at where we've had these dramatic events around the country, or even not so dramatic events around the country, the neighborhoods that are impacted most are the neighborhoods with the least. And what we need to do is think about how we deploy these resources. And our brownfields programs and our other programs aimed at environmental justice, I think, could be looked at as supporting frameworks for how you analyze where your needs are. And I think you should be able to look to the federal government, or at least EPA, for support in that area and how we could direct some of our not often thought about assets, like our brownfields assets, our cleanup program assets, into those communities to help as you look at your resilience risk going forward. So I close with this point that there's a heck of a lot of uncertainty. And where will the federal government be active? There's a lot of conversation about infrastructure in Washington. I plead with you to be as active as you possibly can to look at that infrastructure issue in a way that is smart. It's possible, as we've seen, someone will show up and say, okay, everything has to be shovel ready and has to go out now, and we'll miss an opportunity, or we'll actually be doing things in 20th century ways instead of 21st century ways. And you may need to get aggressive with federal partners who will be mandated to spend money and spend it now. And so I urge you all in this very mechanical conversation. It's kind of like how do you make us smart as we move forward? Our partners at the Army Corps of Engineers will probably be a big player. Not so much here because Sandy money didn't flow here, but down in Rhode Island, the Army Corps is spending $60 million to raise homes. Was that the smartest framework for doing it? Some of us who read that might think, well, not as smart, but they weren't prepared. They weren't aligned like you. They didn't have the vision like you. They hadn't done the analysis like you. So I think you're very, very important in how the new, whatever comes down the pipe, comes in a smart way and not the old way. I think you can count on the team that's at EPA, if not a public partner, to be a silent partner, quiet partner, behind the scenes partner in that effort. So I'm being somewhat circumspect about this whole thing because there's a lot of uncertainty, but I think you can count on the team. Cynthia Green's here with our climate energy team. Of course, Doug Guthrie, a lot of you know, is here. Feel free to reach out to them as whatever unfolds in a way that is truly helpful to you. One thing we do really well here in New England, which apparently isn't as well done elsewhere, is this issue of collaboration between state, federal, and local partners, working to the betterment, perhaps optimal outcomes, all meeting our interests going forward. We can educate and do it right, and I think I'm very excited to see that you're all here, that you invited us, and that we can be part of this going forward. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Kurt, and thank you, everyone. Thank you, Rebecca. To close out the discussion, I'm going to call on the chairman of the Metro Mayors Coalition and the mayor of Somerville, Mayor Joe Curtatone, is going to speak about the commitment that we're all agreeing to today, and also talk a little bit about the future. And I don't want anyone to leave, at least from the head table, before we get the photo. Very, very critical, okay? So, Mayor Curtatone.
Okay, good morning, and thank you, Mark. I do want to thank my fellow colleagues on the Metropolitan Mayors Coalition. This is a coalition of 14 mayors, managers, CEOs that represent the inner and outer core of the hub. And also, thank you and welcome Secretary Matt Beaton, and thank the governor for their leadership. Mark Drayson, the executive director of the MAPC, along with Rebecca Davis, the deputy director, and the UMass Club. But Kurt, I just realized this is the last probably official thing we'll be doing together. And I want, on behalf of the Metropolitan Mayors Coalition, the MAPC, let me say this. I've been a mayor now and involved in this fantastic organization for the past 13 years. And what is important to us is partnership and collaboration. I think I speak for us all when I say we've never had greater collaboration with EPA Region 1 on such important issues than we've had during your tenure. Thank you very much. We're going to miss you. Appreciate it. And I know I speak for the congressman as well. So I'm going to take this opportunity, I'm going to say a few words, introduce the commitment, give some highlights, and then we're going to have a photo, members of the Metro Mayor's Coalition staff. Please do not leave. Like some of you, Somerville is completing its own city level vulnerability assessment. And we found that by mid-century, severe storms may overtop, as you've heard, the Amelia Earhart Dam, potentially flooding the Assembly Square and Innerbelt neighborhoods. And now these are some of our transformative areas targeted for intense growth, critical for the city's future, where we are seeing substantial investment already, economic development and growth. Thankfully, we currently have cooling centers and backup cooling centers in most vulnerable neighborhoods, but projections indicate that we have insufficient open space and vegetation to cool the homes and streets where most at-risk residents live. Now, we're also working on critical infrastructure on our source system improvements that will increase capacity, but some of our business districts could still be vulnerable to disruptions as precipitation causes, as we're seeing more and more frequent flooding as a consequence of more severe and intense storms. Some of all, as you've already heard, is also collaborating with our neighbors on addressing climate change. We've been coordinating with Cambridge and Boston to file joint comments to the Department of Public Utilities and accessibility and affordability of solar energy, especially for the residents in dense urban areas like ours. And I do want to give a special shout out to the city of Boston and in particular Mayor Martin Walsh with his leadership. He's taken this issue on with incredible passion and tenacity. So thank you, Mr. Mayor, for your leadership in this. We have been sharing data and best practices on climate change planning with Cambridge and Boston and Medford, Quincy and others. And along with Cambridge, we've been supporting Boston's Coastal Resilience Project funded by Coastal Zone Management in Sullivan Square. Now, as for the introducing the mitigation commitment, this task force, as you've heard, the task force working on this and leading this has made great progress in our region's preparedness for climate change. And part of that preparation is to mitigate impacts by, for example, moving away from fossil fuels that emit greenhouse gases. And we've also talked about adaptation, but I'd submit, and we believe, that the best adaptation strategy is mitigation. These two issues, mitigation and adaptation, however, are inextricably linked. We know that cities need to take the lead. More than half, 54% of the world's population lives in city regions, and by 2050, more than three quarters of the world's population will live in city regions. And city regions around the world are setting the standard on climate, taking on the challenges of climate change and environmental sustainability. And we know that cities produce 70% of the world's emissions, and urban areas and a home in this country for more than 80% of Americans. The Paris Climate Agreement in 2015, which has now been ratified by UN members, pays special attention to cities because of the important roles they play as population centers. And the commitment that we have signed and outlining today is our chance to move forward as a region, to put forward a bold step and to be at the cutting edge, in the leading edge of this movement in this country and around the world. Making this commitment is also in our economic best interest. Paying for fossil fuels, for example, the people of Somerville alone sent more than $135 million per year outside of the Massachusetts economy. So we should be seizing the opportunity to stimulate our economy instead by using less energy, making our own, and frankly, buying cleaner. As the only city in Massachusetts with a community-wide carbon neutrality goal coming into this, we recognize that we have been creative, that we have to be creative, and consider all options and prepare for those that have not yet been invented. We will mitigate and we will adapt. If we compromise on those goals, however, over time, all we will have left to do is explain. We'll have to explain to our younger and future generations why we failed to take action, but we still could. Given the uncertainty and the ever-changing national political climate, not changing fast enough as far as I'm concerned, it is all the more urgent that cities and regions rise up to this responsibility. It is in the city regions where you find the most practical and prudent leadership. With all due respect to our great friends and our great governor here in the state of Massachusetts, sometimes things happen at the state level. Very little happens in Washington.
It's at the city levels around the world where leaders and communities are collaborating and adapting to take on legacy issues around public health, mobility, sustainability, and taking on the challenges of climate change. This is a bold step for this region, but a necessary step if we're serious about addressing what is nothing short of an existential crisis. We thank you for coming in today. I want to thank, again, all my colleagues of the Metropolitan Mayor's Coalition who are here today. You heard from Mayor Warren from Newton, Mayor Stephanie Resiti-Burke from Medford, a great leader from the City of Boston, Martin Walsh, the Vice Chair of the Coalition, Mayor Rob Dolan, Jim McKenna from Winthrop. I don't know if anyone else is here, but we speak on the entire 14 members and saying that being part of this coalition is really a remarkable part of our work that we do today. And the staffs of each of our communities, we want to thank you for your hard work, folks. And we want to give you another round of applause for what you've done to put it into this room. So I'm going to close it out. We thank you for coming, and we invite the coalition and others to come up to take a photo. Thank you.